I want to present to you, Rejoice in the Lord. And as I do this, I would like for you to continue to pray for me as I speak. Ephesians 5:20, we just read it. Giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Do we give thanks in all things? Sometimes it's difficult. You know, I was really appreciative when Sandy, when she was speaking this morning, I heard her and it's like, well, you know, you're actually talking about some of the things I was going to talk about at the same time. So you built a fire on me. You started me off right. I appreciate that. I appreciate that. But giving thanks in all things. If you turn to Psalms 104, turn to Psalms 104. We're going to talk about that as well a little bit. Get there, say amen. Psalms 104.
Amen.
It says, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving. Ephesians 5:20, giving thanks. I'm going to start off with something that's we all know is happening right now. I was here at Thanksgiving time. November 23rd is a Wednesday. And as a Wednesday, I was driving over from West Virginia and Pennsylvania, went to visit my brother, then visit my sister-in-law and my wife, and we came. And as I was coming, a pastor for the Marian Church had called me. He says, Todd, could you preach this weekend? And I said, well, yeah, I can preach this weekend. Same time, just a few minutes later, my pastor from Orlando, from Florida, called me, because that's where I'm from, had called me and says, Todd, can you preach this weekend? I said, Pastor, you must have forgot I'm not in Florida. So I preached at the Marian Church, but I started my sermon, and I had several sermons I hadn't preached at the Marian Church, so I thought, well, you know, I need something different. It was Thanksgiving. I needed something that I felt, you know, would relate, that we need to give thanks to the Lord, that we need to be thankful, that we're spending time with our family. So I started studying, and the Lord put together, and as I was trying to come up with a name for the sermon, I thought, wow, a thankful Thanksgiving. You know, this is a thankful Thanksgiving. A lot of us spend time with our families and the people we love and care about. And so I started working on that sermon. It didn't give me much time, but I put something together Wednesday night and Thursday, and I finished actually Friday morning, but the majority was already written Thursday night. Well, we was coming over from West Virginia, and as I was coming over, I called my father. Called him a couple times, and I didn't get an answer. It was troubling because I was heading to his house, and I didn't get an answer. And my wife and I got a hotel room and so forth that Wednesday, and I worked on a sermon. My father called me Thursday morning, and he says, Todd, he says, I'm in the hospital, and, you know, I had a bad back. You know, I've got so much pain, I had to go to the hospital. And just tell everyone at the church, our Thanksgiving, that I'm not going to be there. And I said, I can do that, no problem. I went to Thanksgiving and I told everybody that, you know, my father couldn't make it, you know, that, you know, he's in the hospital right now, but, you know, it'd be okay and so forth. But he didn't want anybody to see him, and that was okay too. So we had Thanksgiving and everything, and Dad told me he's going to have a short, small procedure Friday morning and everything. So my brother, who I met at Thanksgiving, he came over from Pennsylvania, you know, we had talked a little bit about Thursday, about Dad being in the hospital, but my brother didn't say anything to me, and he thought it was unusual to have that procedure right after Thanksgiving. Usually people were gone for the holidays from the hospital, at least doctors taking that time off. So we got up Friday morning, and he was real anxious to get to the hospital. And I didn't understand at the time why he was so anxious to get to the hospital. But we got there, and Gail was there, and we're waiting for Dad to come out of the procedure. And what had happened was, the doctor came out, and He says, you know, we had the procedure and everything. And he said, I want to tell you something. He says, he's very straightforward. And he says, your father has cancer, and it's colon cancer. And we took it very hard. It was my brother and I and my wife and our brother's wife and Gail. A lot of emotions you can feel, think, that was going through us at that point in time. But then he says, you know, it's inoperable. Well, actually, before he said that, I said, well, how large? Is it the size of a quarter? I don't know. When people say they've got cancer, is it a quarter size? Is it the size of a dime? You know, how big is it? He says, no, it's larger than a quarter. And then he said it was inoperable. And he told us where it was at and everything. So we started thinking about it. We went back to visit my father and so forth, and my brother and I left. And I never understood how somebody could get angry, being angry at God. But I shouldn't be angered at God, but I was getting angry, and very angry. Because here my father, I know, as you know, comes to this church, lives a very faithful life, very dedicated life, very healthy life. And I see people on the streets and, you know, they're drinking and they're doing this and doing that. And the guy's 80 years old and has been doing this for all his life. And the more I thought, I kept getting angry. But I turned to the Bible and it said in Ephesians, give thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of Jesus. It's like, man, how do I give thanks for something like this? How do I give thanks? But you know, the Lord knows the beginning from the end. He knows what is best for us. You know, the trials that we go through is to make us stronger. We must understand that. Some are hard trials. But I want to read this from you. This is from Acts of the Apostles. It says, let us be thankful that through painful pruning, we may retain a connection with the living vine. It didn't say just pruning. It said painful pruning. We're going to have some things that's going to cause us a lot of pain. We are going to have those times. But we must rejoice that it says we may retain a connection with the living vine. For if we suffer with Christ, we shall also reign with Him. The very trial that taxes our faith the most severely and makes it seem as though God had forsaken us is to lead us more closely to Him, that we may lay all our burdens at the feet of Christ and experience the peace which He will give us in exchange. God loves and cares for the feeblest of His creatures, and we cannot dishonor Him more than by doubting His love to us. Oh, let us cultivate that living faith that will trust Him in the hour of our darkness and trial. We must never give up. Do not doubt the Lord Jesus. Rejoice in what He can do. I just know it's from Acts of the Apostles. I can probably get it to you later, but it's on Acts of the Apostles. You know, it's interesting because you probably didn't see me before the sermon. I was sitting in here and I try to think on holy thoughts and try to cleanse myself and ask the Holy Spirit to come upon me and so forth. And as I'm sitting in there, I look up and right at this end, it's like, that's one of my verses. It says, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. 1 Thessalonians 5:18. Give thanks. Give thanks. You know, like I said, it hurt when I heard that. So that night I prayed. This is Friday night. I prayed and I prayed and I prayed. But I'd just written a song, not a song, but a sermon, stating a thankful Thanksgiving. And then I was going to preach this the next day. Oh, how hard this was going to be to preach a sermon, a thankful Thanksgiving, to hear what my father is going through. But then I had to rejoice in the things that I had to add to it, because Friday I did work up my sermon. I added things. I found out that we need to rejoice, be thankful, you know, because these painful pruning is building your character. It's building your faith in Christ. Let peace of God rule in your hearts, and be ye thankful. Colossians 3:15. Forgetting our difficulties, forgetting our own difficulties and troubles, let us praise God for our opportunity to live for the glory of His name. Let the fresh blessings of each new day awaken praise in our hearts for these tokens of His loving care. When ye open your eyes in the morning, give thanks. We need to give thanks all the time, just not when we feel like it. I feel like it. It's a good day. It's sunny. I'm going to give thanks. Got to give thanks in the cloudy days, the rainy days, the days that you got 2 feet of snow. I know you up here in Ohio don't like that too well, but there's reasons for a lot of this stuff, and we might not understand. Give thanks that you're running 15 minutes late. Don't hurry. There might have been a car accident right at that intersection you was going to be at because you didn't get there in time. Give thanks. It's going to be revealed to us all the times that Christ was there. His angels were there. It will be revealed to us. And we don't understand some of the things that are happening to us, but it will be revealed to us. When someone asks how you are feeling, do not try to think of something mournful to tell in order to gain sympathy. Do not talk of your lack of faith and your sorrows and suffering. Do we talk about our sorrows sometimes? Oh, poor me. Poor me. You know, I'm broke. I don't have any food. But it's the tempter's delight to hear such words. Because when you're talking on gloomy subjects, you are glorifying. Are you glorifying Christ? No. It says you are glorifying him, which is Satan. We are not to dwell on the great power of Satan to overcome us. Often we give ourselves into his hands by talking of his power. We shouldn't be talking about that. When we feel down, we need to say, thank you, Lord. God bless you. You are with me. I should not fear anything in this world. If you truly have God with you, you will not fear anything that comes your way. Let us talk instead of the great power of God to bind up all our interest with His own. Tell of the matchless power of Christ and speak of His glory. All heaven is interested in our salvation. Have we not reason to be thankful every moment? Thankful even when there are apparent difficulties in our pathway? Wow. We all have very much to be thankful for. Let us open our lips in praise and thanksgiving to God. Let us come near to the Lord Jesus and acknowledge our daily obligation to Him. Do we have obligations here on this earth to Him? We do. Don't we have in our three angels' message that we should be doing probably every day? There's message. The three angels' message we should be getting out. We should be preaching this to the world. Elder Kent just spoke that he walked into a store, you know, a gas station, holding the great controversy. And he walked in and a gentleman asked him, you know, what is that? It's more important to hold a Bible, hold a book that lets people know what kind of person you are. If you're holding a Bible and you walk into a store, if you're holding a great controversy, a desire of ages, it might pique somebody's interest to say, what is that? What is that? They know, they begin to see that, you know, you love Jesus, you are sharing, you've got something you're reading that deals with Christ. There are so many ways to witness. So many ways. So giving thanks, thanksgiving to God. Let us come near to the Lord Jesus and acknowledge our daily obligations to Him. He has made it possible for us to secure ourselves a very happy life, even in this world of sin, and to secure for and holds out the hope of being continually in His presence in the kingdom He is preparing for His people. Should not these thoughts call forth from us praise and thanksgiving? How many times do you think, you know, the Lord has a place for me? I've got a mansion in the sky. A mansion. I know we don't have some of that. Sometimes some of us don't have much here. But you can rejoice that God has set aside a place for you. For you. Rejoice. Be happy. We do not realize the thousand dangers that our Heavenly Father has kept us from. I just mentioned that. We do not realize that. We do not realize the great blessings that He has bestowed upon us in giving us food, raiment, and preserving our lives by sending the guardian angel to watch over us. Every day we should be thankful for this. We ought to have gratitude stirring in our hearts and come to God with a gratitude offering every day. We ought to gather around the family altar every day and praise Him. Praise Him for His watch and care over us. Amen. Amen. That He is watching over us. Where would this world be without our Lord? I'm going to touch on that in just a second. We are ever to be thankful that Jesus has proved to us by actual facts that man can keep the commandments of God. God came here as a man. My father and I talked about this earlier this week. We got to be thankful that He came as a man. You know, some people says, well, you know, the divinity parted Him, you know, gave Him the power to overcome. If that was the case, He is not a true sacrifice for us. Giving contradiction to Satan's falsehood that man cannot keep them. The great teacher came to our world to prepare at the head of humanity, to thus elevate and sanctify humanity by His holy obedience to all of God's requirements, showing it is possible to obey all the commandments of God. He has demonstrated that a lifelong obedience is possible. Thus, He gave men to the world as the Father gave the Son to exemplify in their life the life of Jesus Christ. You know, we need to be very thankful for that. I want to talk to you about Christ. And if Christ and His Father did not have a plan before the world. Think about that. What is the transgression of God's law? What is it? It's sin, right? What is sin? Transgression of law. But sin? Sin is death. It equals death. If there had not been anything, right? Sin is death. That's what the outcome of sin is. So, if there was not the plan before time, before this world, soon as Adam and Eve sinned, transgressed God's law, and sinned, there would have been what? There would have been death. We need to rejoice. I need to rejoice that I know you. You need to rejoice that you have children, that you have a grandfather, grandmother. Because for without that plan, none of us would have known each other. It would have been done. Rejoice that he had a plan. Rejoice that he has given us a chance. We need to rejoice that this has happened. So if you have a family member that is sick, if you have a family member you haven't talked to, you have a friend that's at home sick, spend time with them. Build memories, build great memories, because God gave you the chance to do that. Spend time, make beautiful memories. You know, I want to talk to you a little bit about what's going to happen. You know, that was part of my sermon, but there's something I need to touch on right now before. It's going to be a little while here, but I want to touch on this because this is very important on this day. Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. James 5:15. Here in probably about a half hour, we're going to have an anointing. But before we have that anointing, I want to do some reflection on some of the things we need to be focused on and thinking about while we're doing this. I'm going to read a little bit from Faith I Live By. Much prayer, sober reflection is needed. Affection cannot be lasting, even in the home circle, unless there is a conformity of the will and disposition to the will of God. All the faculties and passions are to be brought into harmony with the attributes of Jesus Christ. If the father and mother, in the love and fear of God, unite their interests to have authority in the home, they will see the necessity of much prayer, much sober reflection. And as they seek God, their eyes will be opened to see heavenly messengers present to protect them in answer to the prayer of faith. They will overcome the weaknesses of their character and go on unto perfection. This is the faith I live by here on this 3:15:3. Why is it that men are so unwilling to trust him who created man and who can, by a touch, a word, a look, heal all manner of disease? Who is more worthy of our confidence than the one who has made so great a sacrifice for our redemption? Our Lord has given us definite instruction through the Apostle James as to our duty in case of sickness. When human help fails, God will be the helper of his people. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church. Let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick. And the Lord shall raise him up. James 5:14. But the offering of such prayer is most solemn act and should not be entered upon without careful consideration. To those who desire prayer for their restoration to health, it should be made plain that the violation of God's law, either natural or spiritual, is sin. And that in order for them to receive his blessing, sin must be confessed and forsaken. We know that God hears us if we ask according to his will. But to press our petitions without submissive, listen to that. Don't force. Do not press your petitions without submissive spirit. Without a submissive spirit is not right. Our prayers must take the form not of command, but of intercession. There are cases where God works decidedly by his divine power to the restoration of health. But not all sick are healed. Many are laid away to sleep in Jesus. Our desires and interests should be lost in His will. Our desires and interests should be lost in His will. We should be thinking of Him. Everything that we do, we should be thinking of the Lord. These experiences that test faith are not for our benefit. Faith is strengthened by exercise. We must let patience have its perfect work, remembering that there are precious promises in the Scriptures for those who wait upon the Lord. Amen. Amen. There are precious promises in the Scriptures. Do we claim those promises? We should. We should. As to praying for the sick, it is too important a matter to be handled carelessly. I believe we should take everything to the Lord and make known to God all our weaknesses and specify all our perplexities. When in sorrow, when uncertain as to what course to pursue, two or three who are accustomed to pray should unite together in asking the Lord to let His light shine upon them and to impart His special grace. And He will respect their petitions. He will answer their prayers. If we are under infirmities of body, it is certainly consistent to trust in the Lord, making supplications to our God in our own case. And if we feel inclined to ask others in whom we have confidence to unite with us in prayer to Jesus, who is the mighty healer, help will surely come if we ask in faith. Help will surely come if we ask in faith. Faith is important. Come if we ask of faith. I think we are altogether too faithless and too cold and too lukewarm. That's what Ellen White said. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. Oh, how grateful we should be that Jesus is willing and able to bear all our infirmities and strengthen and heal all our diseases, if it will be for the good and for His glory. There is power. Will heal all diseases. Oh, how grateful we should be that Jesus is willing. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Oh, how grateful we should be that Jesus is willing and able to bear all our infirmities and strengthen and heal all our diseases, if it will be for the good and for His glory. Amen. Now I'm going to break it down as we talk about prayer. I want to read this to you. I want to break it down as prayer. It says, the Scripture says that men ought always to pray and not faint. Luke 18:1. Will prepare us for prayer for this afternoon, because this afternoon we're going to break off into small groups here, but the elders are going to go over there to anoint my father. So I want to prepare us for prayer. It says, and if ever there is time when they feel their need of prayer, it is when strength fails and itself seems slipping from their grasp. Often those who are in health forget the wonderful mercies continued to them day by day, year after year, and they render no tribute of praise to God for His benefits. But when sickness comes, God is remembered. When human strength fails, men feel their need of divine help, and never does our merciful God turn from the soul that in sincerity seeks Him for help. He is our refuge in sickness and in health. Amen?
Amen.
Christ is the same compassionate physician now that he was during His earthly ministry. In Him there is healing, balm for every disease, restoring power for every infirmity. His disciples in this time are to pray for the sick as verily as the disciples of old prayed. Do you believe that we can still heal today? That God can heal today, not us. That God can heal today. There is no difference from then than there is now, except for the amount of time in this world has been spent. For Christ, there is healing power still this day. And I believe that with all my heart. I always have. Always have. His disciples in this time are to pray for the sick. I read that. Sick. As verily as the disciples of old. And recoveries will follow. For the prayer of faith shall save the sick. We have the Holy Spirit's power. The calm assurance of faith that can claim God's promises. The Lord's promise. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Mark 16:18. Is just as trustworthy now as in the days of the apostle. It presents the privilege of God's children. And our faith should lay hold of all that it embraces. Christ's servants are the channel of his working. And through them, his desires to exercise his healing power, it is our work to present the sick and suffering to God in the arms of our faith. We should teach them to believe in the great healer. The Savior would have us encourage the sick, the hopeless, the afflicted, to take hold upon his strength. We should not give the sick any means of negative thought. Oh, I'm feeling down. I'm feeling low. We need to uplift them with Scripture. We need to uplift them and say, God is with you always. Do you know that there is a condition for an answered prayer? How many know that there are conditions for answered prayer? If you haven't heard it, there are conditions for answered prayer. I'm going to read this. That's why I said I was going to prepare us for this afternoon. But only as we live in obedience to his word can we claim the fulfillment of his promises. The psalmist says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. Psalm 66:18. If we render to him only partial or a half-hearted obedience, his promises will not be fulfilled. You know, sometimes we have people that pray over people and then we ask why God did not intervene and help this person out. I don't think they understand that there's a condition for healing. In the Word of God, we have instruction relative to special prayer for the recovery of sick. But the offering of such prayer is a most solemn act and should not be entered upon without careful consideration. In many cases of prayer for the healing of the sick, that which is called faith is nothing less than presumption. Many persons bring disease upon themselves by their self-indulgence. They have not lived in accordance with the natural law or the principles of strict purity. Others have disregarded the laws of health in their habits of eating and drinking, dressing, or working. Often some form of vice is the cause of their feebleness of mind or body. Should these persons gain the blessings of health, many of them would continue to pursue the same course of heedless transgression of God's natural and spiritual laws. I want you to understand this one here, because I'm going to read this twice. Reasoning that if God heals them in answer to prayer, they are at liberty to continue their unhealthful practices and to indulge perverted appetite without restraint. If God were to work a miracle in restoring these persons to health, he would be encouraging sin. Wow. That's powerful. So when you think about why some people are not healed, maybe need to think about, well, what's going to happen when they are healed. We live in a society, a sinful society right now. I don't have to say it. You know, you turn to a newspaper, you see something, and you see it happen all the time. But there is a reason. If God were to work a miracle in restoring these persons to health, He would be encouraging sin. He would be encouraging for that person who goes out and eats 10 Big Macs a week to continue to eat 10 Big Macs a week. I'm good. I'm healthy now. I can go ahead and re-eat that. But they don't have the health. It is labor lost to teach people to look to God as a healer of their infirmities unless they are taught as also to lay aside unhealthy practices. In order to receive His blessing in answer to prayer, they must cease to do evil and learn to do well. Their surroundings must be sanitary, their habits of life correct. They must live in harmony with the law of God, both natural and spiritual. To those who desire prayer for the restoration to health, it should be made plain that the violation of God's law, either natural or spiritual, is sin. And that in order for them to receive His blessing, sin must be confessed and forsaken. This looks like it's going to work out just right. I've got one more part here I want to talk to you about. It's called unwavering faith. This is from Maranatha. Let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. James 1:6. Prayer and faith are closely allied, and they need to be studied together in the prayer of faith. There is a divine science. Did you know there's a science in prayer? How you pray? I'll go over that with you right now. There's a science. It is a science that everyone who would make his life work a success must understand. Christ says, "What things soever ye desire, when ye pray, believe that ye receive them, and ye shall have them." Mark 11:24. He makes it plain that our asking must be in according to God's will. You know, I told you that I was angry when I first found out. And I had to do a lot of preparation and reading and talking to God. And whatever happens with my Father, I'm good. Because I believe in the Father. I believe whatever is His will. He knows us better. He knows the beginning and from the end. He knows what we need. He knows what we need. He makes it plain that our asking must be according to God's will. We must ask for the things that He has promised. He has promised if we ask. I just read it to you also, that if we ask, you can overcome sickness. But there is also a condition. All these things must line up. And whatever we receive must be used in doing His will. The conditions met, the promises unequivocal. For the pardon of sin, for the Holy Spirit, for a Christ-like temper. Sometimes that's hard. For wisdom and strength to do His work. For any gift He has promised, we may ask. Then we are to believe that we received and return thanks to God that we have received it. Sometimes we leave that part out. I know I have in the past. You know, you ask in prayer for something. Thank you, Lord, for receiving it. Sometimes I thank Him for it's taken care of. Once you ask, it's taken care of. But you got to have those steps. And return thanks to God that we have received whatever we've asked. We need look for no outward evidence of the blessing. The gift is in the promise, and we may go about our work assured that what God has promised, He is able to perform, and that the gift which we already possess will be realized when need it most. To live thus by the word of God means the surrender to Him of the whole life. There will be felt a continual sense of need and dependence, a drawing out of the heart after God. Prayer is a necessity, for it is the life of the soul. Family prayer, public prayer have their place, but it is secret communion with God that sustains the soul life. An intensity such as never before was seen is taking possession of the world. In amusement and money, in the contest of power, in the very struggle for existence, there is a terrible force that engrosses body and mind and soul. In the midst of this maddening rush, God is still speaking to us. He bids us come apart and commune with Him. Be still and know that I am God. Not a pause for a moment in His presence, but personal contact with Christ to sit down in companionship with Him. This is our need. I'm going to go back. I rejoice that I have a wonderful Father. I rejoice to the Lord that He has brought me upright. I rejoice in the Lord that I've had time to spend with Him. I rejoice in the Lord that I've had time to spend with you. I'm finishing here. Because God knows what is best for all of us. We might not know what is best for us, but God does. We must think about that. We must rejoice. Give God thanks in everything. Kent,